again, everyone. I'm Bruce Beck. Welcome to Comcast Sports Talk for a Thursday evening. Tonight, our final flashback of the Final Four. Tuesday, we took a look back at the 1985 Villanova Wildcats, who captured the national championships. Our guests included Mark Plansky and Harold Jensen. Last night, we reflected on the 1989 Seton Hall Club, which went to the NCAA championship game before bowing out to Michigan. We shared some thoughts with Pookie Wigington. And tonight, we go back 21 years to 1976, when the Scarlet Knights of Rutgers went to the Final Four in Philadelphia. Our guests, two of the all-time greats for the Scarlet Knights, Phil Sellers and Hollis Copeland. Sellers, the all-time leading scorer and rebounder for the Scarlet Knights, with 2,399 points and 1,115 boards. He was a two-time All-America, a two-time winner of the Hagerty Award as the Met Area Player of the Year, and a 1993 inductee of the Rutgers Basketball Hall of Fame. His number 12 hangs from the rafters at the Rutgers Athletic Center. Also joining us in the studio is Hollis Copeland, who enjoyed a marvelous career on the banks. He was the school's number 5 all-time leading scorer and ranked 5th on the school's all-time rebounding list. He was a 1977 All-America. The Trenton native was a 1996 inductee of the Rutgers University Basketball Hall of Fame. You know, it was called the unforgettable season. And tonight should be an unforgettable look back. Phil the Thrill Sellers and Hollis Copeland on Comcast Sports Talk tonight, reflecting back on the 31-2 1976 Rutgers Final Four team. Before we get to hoops, though, a big game locally. Coming up next in Comcast Sports Talk with Phil Sellers and Hollis Copeland as we relive the 1976 Rutgers University Scarlet Knight team that went to the Final Four. Stay with us. Welcome back to Comcast Sports Talk, a special week here on the Comcast Network as we look back at Final Fours past in anticipation of the upcoming Final Four in Indianapolis this weekend. And tonight, it's the 1976 season, and believe it or not, it's 21 years ago exactly tonight that the Rutgers University basketball team played in their first ever and only Final Four. They went down to Philadelphia, and tonight we'll relive that season, the Final Four, and much more with Phil the Thrill Sellers and Hollis Copeland. And gentlemen, great to see you both.
Bruce, pleasure to be here.
Thanks, Bruce.
Phil, that was a ball club which gave a lot of Jerseyans a thrill of a lifetime. Your thoughts on what made that team special?
Well, you know, Bruce, 10 years after the fact, you know, I didn't really realize the impact of that team had on the state of New Jersey. What made that team really a great team is the friendship we had on and off the court, which I felt was very important. And with that in mind, it just helped us play better as a team. So, I mean, you couldn't beat that at all.
Hollis, the word that's used often and sometimes overused is chemistry. Did this ball club have that chemistry?
Yes, it did. It did. Camaraderie amongst the players, the coach. We always we communicated well. I think that Ed knew me. I knew Phil. We knew what we wanted to be. You know, if the alley-oop was there, it was there. You know, we had coherence. You know, we were all connected. And that's what it takes. You know, we on and off the floor. You know, if somebody had a problem, we talk about it. Just like friends.
And Phil, there were so many different groups there because you had the young buck, Bailey, he was just a freshman. You had Copeland, who was a sophomore. You had you and Dabney, the senior leaders, and Eddie Jordan, a junior. So you had representation from every class of the university, and you were able to mesh that group.
Which was great. And I give Tom a lot of credit for that, putting that team together. I mean, he recruited the guys that he felt that, you know, would come in and contribute a great deal to the success of the team. And I give Tom a lot of credit in each year bringing in a player that actually fit into the system perfectly.
Hollis, you ran through the regular season undefeated. I think if there was a game early on, the people kind of opened up their eyes. It was at Boston College, and they were a good team, and you beat them by 20 or so on the road, and all of a sudden people said, hey, this club is really for real.
Yeah, it was funny. We were just out there having fun. You know, playing a game, the game was relaxing compared to practice. You know, practice, we went at each other. So, you know, when we got on the floor during a game, it was like, you know, piece of cake. We really had fun out there. And Tom Young, he had fun coaching during that time. I remember him with his towel and, you know,
that's
covering
right,
his mouth
towel,
up.
The ever-present
right.
towel, similar to Max Zavlosky. He was coaching the old New Jersey Americans in the ABA. But Young was there with the towel. And Phil, sometimes he was kind of taciturn on the bench, and other times he was very vocal.
Yes, and that's the intensity that Tom carried. You know, Bruce, just reflecting on that Boston game, when we did play Boston at Boston was kind of considered to be better than us. And at that time, we felt that we were better than Boston. So we went up there with a mission to prove a few things. And also, it was a homecoming for James Bailey, a freshman who had stepped into the lineup that particular game. So we wanted to play well and look good in front of his crowd and do some good things for him. And I'll be honest with you, I was very surprised that we went up there and played as well as we did.
Taking your phone calls tonight at 1-888-COMCAST. That's 1-888-COMCAST, talking to Phil Sellers and Hollis Copeland about the 76 Rutgers University team. And Hollis, you beat some pretty good clubs that year. Purdue, Boston College, Temple, Georgia Tech, Pittsburgh, West Virginia, Syracuse. During the regular season, you guys had a very demanding schedule because back then there wasn't such a thing in terms of being a big league alliance. It was more like you played anybody anywhere.
Exactly. We thought that we had a team that we were set out to prove something. You know, the guys meshed well. Coach, he had his stellar year coaching. JB coming in as a freshman. Phil's there, you know, the leader, Ed. And you know what? Our defense made our offense.
You know, you're right. People talk about your offense because you did score over 111 different times. But, Phil, it was the relentless full-court pressure on occasions that really frustrated opposing teams.
Yeah, we knew we had the guys that can pull that kind of aggressive move off. We had a very fast team. We had two guys on the team that came from track backgrounds in Hollis Copeland and Mike Dabney. So with a guy like Eddie, who was naturally fast, a lot of people often wondered, how did I get out on the break and how did I sometimes became the leading scorer of some games, considering I had guys that was a lot faster.
Yeah. But they found you in the open court, and Fast Eddie did a great job of distributing in the open court.
I think he did a fabulous job with that. And through that, it's really balanced us out as we began to play more and more games and get further into the season.
Hollis, what was Tom Young doing there with that leisure suit look? I mean, really, that really reflects the age of the 70s.
I don't think I'm going to touch that one.
Scarlet Knights of Rutgers were 31-2, and there's a look back at that leisure suit once again. But that was the 70s. And the Knights were 10-0 at home and 21-2 on the road. But I always felt that at the bar, you were almost unbeatable and could have been if you played 40 games there that year, Phil.
Well, we was relentless on constantly attacking the defense. And I know a lot of teams just hate playing against us because of the fact that we just constantly came at you. And I know there was times where Tom had to call a timeout just to kind of get us to run some offense that we worked so hard on during practice. And, I mean, it was funny because Tom would just out of nowhere call a timeout and say, hey, guys, you know, let's see if we can run a play that we work on.
But, you know, oftentimes great teams, in addition to running the play and executing, had an ability to freelance and had an ability, Hollis, to find the guy even when things broke down. And Phil certainly thrived in a situation of a breakdown game because he was a one-on-one guy from the playground of Brooklyn first and foremost.
Exactly. We knew Phil had a nice jump shot. He created his own shot oftentimes. He had the size to make openings, create openings for himself, and we knew that. Mike Dabney and I, we were more or less transition ball players. You know, we both won the state high jump championship when we were in high school, so we were the leapers, you know, so to speak. And we liked getting out on the break. Phil, by the way, he was more or less the secondary offense. When it broke down, we went right to Phil. And JB inside. Of course, Ed could create his own shot.
All right, let's see who's checking in on line three in Comcast Sports Talk. Our number tonight, 1-888-COMCAST. Hello?
Hello.
Who's this?
Abdel Anderson.
Abdel, how are you? Another key ingredient of that Rutgers championship team from Belleville, New Jersey, right, Abdel?
Hey.
How you doing, buddy?
Doing well.
All right, you got the floor. I know you want to say hello to the guys.
I sure do.
Ab, speak up a little bit. We can barely hear you.
Yeah. Hey, Phil.
Yeah.
I wonder how come you and Hollis never passed me the ball.
You know, Abdel, we kind of looked at you as being a rookie, so we didn't want you to get too much publicity. But all in all, if anybody reflects back on that year, I think you had a great year as a freshman yourself. You surprised a lot of people with a lot of things that you did. So maybe we wasn't too quick to share the ball with you.
I don't know about that, Ab. I remember sharing the ball with you quite a few times. You know, how soon do we forget?
Well, I tell you what, being with you and Hollis and the rest of the guys, you know, you guys taught me a lot. And as you said before, we were a team on and off the court, and it was really, really good experience, and it's all because of you guys.
Well, Abdel Anderson, as a freshman that year, averaged 9.4 points and 4.4 rebounds, which is quite productive considering the plethora of talent on that ball club, Phil.
Exactly. And that's exactly what I was talking about, how, you know, he came in as a sixth man off the bench and really gave us some things that we were desperately needing at times in the game. So, you know, I give Abdel a lot of credit for being a freshman who took on a lot of challenges and came out successful.
And Abdel, you think about the rest of the guys that came off the bench, players such as Heffley and Kleinbaum, and a lot of these guys really could have started at another team in that particular year.
Oh, yeah, no question about it. And as the guys spoke of earlier, everybody had their role to play. There were no selfish ball players on the team. Everybody gave, you know, everything they had. We had no egos on the team, and everybody was just focused as to what we had to do. And it was a tribute to Tom and Phil and Dip and all the leaders of the team, and it worked out well.
All right, Abdel, we appreciate you sharing some thoughts with us tonight, and we wish you the best.
Thank you. Take care, guys.
Take care, Ab.
Take care.
Abdel Anderson, number 54, part of that Rutgers championship team from 1976, which went to the Final Four. More coming up with Phil Sellers and Hollis Copeland, so stay with us. Comcast Sports Talk for a Thursday night, talking about the Rutgers Final Four team from 1976, and we are getting phone calls from everywhere. Spending the evening here with Phil Sellers and Hollis Copeland, and look who we popped up, Mike Dabney. How you doing, Mike?
I'm doing great. How you doing?
All right. You know, we said earlier we were trying to find you. Your number, I guess, is unlisted. Is that correct?
That's correct. Yeah.
All right. So we apologize for not getting you formally on the show, but we're glad to spend some time with you. And you got the floor, a chance to talk to the boys.
Fantastic. How you doing, Phil?
Mike, good to hear from you.
Hollis.
Hey, Dip. How you feeling, man?
Good. I just want to reiterate on some things that Abdel said, and that was basically that the team was very unselfish, and Tom let us play. There's no question that Tom let us be ourselves. I see a lot of teams now where the players, they look over at their coach, you know, when they make a mistake, something goes wrong, they look over their coach. We never did that as players. We looked at our teammates. We owed our teammates an explanation, not necessarily a coach. But going back to, you know, the 76 season, there was no question about it. Everyone on there was an unselfish player, and they sacrificed their own game for the good of the whole.
Phil, what about your relationship with Dabney? Because you guys always seem to go together like peanut butter and jelly.
Well, you know, me and Mike came in together as freshmen, and it was right there. We were very competitive. You know, Mike was the best player coming out of New Jersey, I think, at the time, and I was the best player coming out of New York. And here we're both together at the same school, and Mike had the ability to be a great player at any university that he had gone to, and I had that same credential. So, you know, me and Mike battled quite often, but we understood that, you know, to be successful, and which we both wanted to be, is that we have to sacrifice, you know, somehow, you know, game to become a unit and become a good team, and that's sure enough what we did.
Mike, how did you embrace the sophomore, Copeland, who had to find his way into the starting lineup?
Well, when Hollis was recruited to the university, you know, that created a change for me. It gave me a good opportunity to go to the two-guard, which was a natural position for
right.
me. Hollis was a natural three-man or the small forward. Enjoyed playing with Hollis. He was a gentleman. He was a good player. He sacrificed. Hollis could have been a star in his own right if he had wanted to, but he sacrificed once again for the whole. But it was a good move for me going to the guard position, the two guard, and he was a welcome addition.
Well, Mike, you had a heck of a year yourself, averaged 19 points, 117 assists, 110 steals, 4.6 boards. You were the consummate team guy and a productive one in every sense of the word, and we appreciate you sharing some thoughts with us tonight, and best of luck to you. What are you doing these days?
My pleasure. I'm a financial consultant.
Great. Thank you so much, guys. Want to say goodbye?
Mike, good hearing from you.
Yeah, man, I'll be in touch.
All right, Dip.
Bye now.
Mike Dabney, who was out of East Orange, and I remember those memorable games against Lou Grimsley in the Essex County Tournament.
That's right.
Grimsley came out of Weequake, and Dabney from East Orange, and the two of them battled at the old Walsh Auditorium, and it was a tremendous game. But Dabney had the qualities, and as I mentioned, it was always Sellers and Dabney you would talk about, but there was a great team all the way. All right, let's get back to the phones. Our number 1-888-COMCAST. That's 1-888-COMCAST. And Scotty from East Orange is checking in. Scotty?
How you doing, Bruce? How you doing, guys?
Scotty, are you old enough to remember Dabney playing for EO?
I can't really think about it.
It was before you became a diehard, addicted Comcast Sports Talk guy, right?
I'm a diehard Comcast fan.
All right, buddy.
Two questions for tonight. First, I want to know, how was it like playing for Tom Young? And secondly, with a record as good as the season you had, how much pressure was it on you to win the Final Four? And did that affect your gameplay?
Very good question.
Good question. Tom, as a coach, Scotty, he didn't have a lot of work to do, you know, because if you reflect back on some of the things that Mike said, we kind of went out there and we played as a unit. And as as that unit, we didn't look back at Tom to do any corrections. So Tom's job as a coach was pretty easy for us because he just, you know, had to sit back. We went out there. He knew that, you know, we were ready to play. He knew that, you know, we knew what to do. So for Tom, it just was easy for him.
Hollis, what about the second part to that question, which was the pressure of going to the Final Four, being undefeated? I know there was a great Indiana team there waiting and a great Michigan team and a quality UCLA team, but you guys came in with lofty undefeated credentials.
That's it. I think that what happened was we went in, we played hard, but we had fun out there. And coming into the Final Four, all of a sudden you see the glitz and the glimmer and this, you know, you kind of like wake up to it. It's like, you know, wait a minute here. We're here and, you know, we're going to have to try to pull this one off, you know. And all of a sudden you're playing against talent that's as good, had the same credentials. Of course, Indiana was undefeated that year also.
Right.
And we were looking beyond Michigan to get the Indiana. Forgot they had a very tough team.
Because, Bruce, if I can reiterate, you know, they were undefeated, and everybody was thinking that it'd be a first time in NCAA history that two undefeated teams would play for the national championship.
Here's a look back at that Final Four at the Spectrum. And, you know, Phil, I thought about your ball club. There were days when Jordan didn't play well. There was days when Sellers and Dabney weren't up to snuff. There was days where Hollis was off. But I don't ever remember a game where you guys all just didn't click as you did in the semifinal game against Michigan, in the first half especially.
And it was strange. It was something that we just wasn't used to, you know. When they looked to me, I couldn't produce. Or if they looked to Mike just seemed couldn't be on. And Eddie, you know, he'll get a basket here and there, but it wasn't enough to carry us. So if anybody can reflect back on that particular game, we pretty much lost that game the first half. You know, the second half we finally got ourselves together, and it was pretty much a balanced game. But the difference was the first half where we probably had a few butterflies. I wouldn't put it past us, you know, a few of the Final Four jitters that we had to finally shake out. But, you can't wait till the game time to, get rid of these things.
No,
you kind of get rid of them before.
And it was 46-29 at the break, and that was the Michigan team with Phil Hubbard and Ricky Green and Steve Grody and Wayman Britt. For the ball game, Michigan shot 50%. Rutgers made just 30 of 76 from the floor, Hollis, and that's just not good enough against that quality of a ball club.
Exactly. We found ourselves being very predictable. After we started reaching, we thought our defense would be able to carry us. You know, usually our defense carries us into our offense, and we relied upon that. It just didn't happen. You know, Ricky Green was a great, you know, ball handler. We found ourselves reaching more. We found ourselves just, you know, out of sync. And for the first 10 minutes, that's where it happened. And the game was won the first 10, 12 minutes. And then we found ourselves trying to play catch-up, which we hadn't done like that all year long.
So in that national semifinal game, Sellers only had 11 points and 8 boards. Copeland had 15. And Rutgers next had a take on UCLA in a consolation game or third-place game. When we come back, we'll talk about what happened when they went up against Marcus Johnson and company. Stay with us on Comcast Sports Talk. We'll be right back. Well, there's no school tomorrow, so the boys are making it here to work the phones. Jonathan Beck in the background along with Ross Berkowitz. And we're taking your phone calls at 1-888-COMCAST. That's 1-888-COMCAST. Talking to Phil the Thrill Sellers out of Thomas Jefferson High School in Brooklyn, New York, where he was a playground legend, went on to play for Rutgers University and then in the NBA for a while with the Detroit Pistons. And Hollis Copeland, who came out of Ewing High School in Trenton, New Jersey, also an All-America for the Scarlet Knights and played in the NBA with, among teams, the New York Knicks. Our phone number, 1-888-COMCAST. And guys, let's talk about the road to the Final Four before we go back to that UCLA game. It opened up with LIU and the ECAC Metro Playoffs, which was a big thing at the time. You steamrolled them 104-78. And then came one of the most memorable games in my life, which was the Rutgers-St. John's game at the Garden. And Hollis, Phil Sellers and Beaver Smith went back and forth at each other down the stretch. I score, you score, I score. Finally, Beaver couldn't match Phil. But four straight times down the floor, Phil scored. And you guys won that game 70-67.
Yeah, Phil was a prolific scorer. I mean, there's no doubt about that. Great drives, had a great knack for the ball. And he and Beaver, Beaver used to jump to the moon. You know, so it was amazing seeing these two guys go up against each other, both from New York. So that, you know, they both had a chip, I believe, on the shoulder.
Phil, I went back in the archives and found the four shots you made. First, you connected on an alley-oop drive. Then you banked one off the glass. Then there was four head fakes, which I remember. Head fake, head fake, head fake. And then you hit the jumper. And then finally, there was a drive. That was a sequence which was definitely a part of Rutgers lore.
The game was very close to us at that time, and we couldn't afford to go down the court and not score because of the simple fact that St. John's, every trip that they went down, they scored. So it was seesawed back and forth, and it made it real interesting. And, you know, I had told Tom that, you know, I would, you know, try to do the best I can and, you know, not really take control, but, you know, I would create something off the offense, off, trying to go to the basket, and I know the defense would, you know, either collapse on me, but apparently they didn't, kind of left me open, and I was able to, you know, with my speed, go around Beaver Smith several times to score hoops.
And Hollis, then came the memorable game against Princeton. It was up in Providence, and if it was not for a fellow named Pete Malloy missing the front end of the 1-1, Rutgers may have never made it to the Final Four because you finally won that game 54-53.
Oh. We've always had a tough time against them. Yeah. they seem to have our number. We were a transition ball club. They were a slow down, set up, back door type of ball club. We had more athleticism. They were more cerebral, so to speak. And you know, that seemed to be dichotomy there. We got to a point where, you know, we're up by one, and this guy, I believe he was 27 for 27, hadn't missed a foul shot all year long. And so I guess our prayers were answered, you know, because he missed the first 10 of a 1-1, I believe. Dip got the rebound.
I think Tom helped us a little bit at that point because
he called a timeout, two timeouts,
right.
It's kind of put the pressure on him a little bit, and
right.
They were big shots.
Right.
You know,
and
he had to really step up and knock those in.
He wasn't comfortable on the line.
I kind of saw the season kind of flash in front of me there. I was like a little concerned that, you know, everything that we had worked so hard for could go right down the drain tonight with these two foul shots if he knocked them in, you know. So.
You know, they say that every team that makes it to the Final Four has to have that one scare or that one close game, and you had a couple, but that was definitely it with the season flashing before your eyes.
Exactly, because Princeton, we had played them during the regular season. We had beat them during the regular season. So when we, you know, when they had the opportunity to play us again, we knew they were going to come and be very physical and be ready to play.
Scarlet Knights of Rutgers, as you look at some vintage footage from 1976, and I believe this was the St. John's game. You know, it's hard to tell with some of these old footage, Phil, but I'll tell you, it's great to see you guys running down the floor as quickly as you are, and Hollis in transition, as always a presence.
Yeah, this is exactly what Hollis was talking about. We was a transition type of ball club, constantly attacking you and making the defense do something. And half the time, we were just too fast for him.
All right, let's say hello to Beverly from Roselle. Hi, Beverly.
Hi.
How are you doing?
I'm good.
Hey, Bev, how are you?
Okay, this is for Hollis.
Okay.
Vintage footage it is. We're looking for a coach. I'm a Rutgers graduate, 1978, and it was great. I was one of their biggest fans.
Go ahead, Beverly. We're with you.
Okay, that's all I want to say. We're looking for a coach, Hollis. What do you think?
Okay.
How about yourself?
It looks good. I mean, right now I believe it's Herrian.
Bill Herrian.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Bill Herrian. And he has great credentials from Drexel. So, I mean, right now, I think that we definitely have to settle on a coach because it enhances the recruiting and everything else seems to fall in line. So we have to make that decision, I guess, this weekend.
But I think she was trying to entice you and get you to man the sidelines. Is it in your blood?
I would love to. I would love to coach, but right now I'm fairly comfortable in what I'm doing.
Tell the viewers what you're up to.
Yeah, I work at Maness Crespi Hart. I'm a broker on the institutional side. And it's great. I have, you know, it's a great firm to work for. Everybody seems to be a friend. They seem to be helping me out. And feel fairly comfortable there. So I have to put that on the back burners at this juncture.
Phil, what about yourself? What are you up to? How's it going?
Me, I work for Chase Manhattan Mortgage Corporation down in Edison, New Jersey. Been there 15 years, and I'm in the process of putting some feelers out there. I think it's time that I, you know, make some moves. And I hopefully one day would like to coach. I had the opportunity to coach as assistant under Tom Young
for 4 years, right?
Yeah. So, you know, I got a feel as to what it's about. So I had enough of corporate America. I think coaching I would like to do before I get
too old, right?
Yeah. I guess. So it'd be, I think, something I've been wanting to do for quite a long time. And it's something I probably look forward to doing.
You know, some of the great coaches have come out of Brooklyn, if you think about it. Lenny Wilkins, right? Doug Moe.
Exactly.
Billy Cunningham. Well, he was the New York connection, not necessarily Brooklyn.
Yeah.
But you can talk about all the great coaches that have come out of New York over the years. It's something that must be either in the water or in the blood or in the air.
Well, I think it's the fact that these guys know the game very well. Because of the fact that if you play any ball in New York City, you're very competitive. The level of the competitiveness is very high. And you got to have an understanding of the game. So if you're a player, it'd make it easier for you to become a coach because of the simple fact that your knowledge of the game is very up there.
Red Auerbach, Eastern District, Bob Cousy, Andrew Jackson. I mean,
long list.
Larry Brown. The list goes on and on. It really does.
Yeah.
All right, let's get back to the phones at 1-888-COMCAST, taking your phone calls, talking about the memorable season for the Scarlet Knights of Rutgers. And before we do that, VMI and UConn were the next two teams following that Princeton victory. That was part of the Rutgers march. First, it was UConn at the Providence Civic Center, and Rutgers won easily, 93-79. Collis, what can you tell me about that bowl game?
We were very coherent. You know, I can't say enough about a lot of the games that we had played where we just fell into a groove. Mm-hmm. Everybody flowed. It seemed like we were just bouncing off of each other. You know, you never get into a set of offense.
Bruce, I think what helped us was the fact that we had played them during the regular season.
Right.
So it wasn't like we were playing a strange team. We were playing a team that we were pretty much familiar with. We were very surprised that they had showed up, you know, to play us again
because
of the simple fact that, you know, they was pretty much, like everyone else, had enough of Rutgers during the regular season. Here, now we got to play them again. So the teams that we were anticipating to run into, like Tennessee, and who had Ernie Grunfeld and Bernard King, those teams wind up getting bumped off.
Right, early.
And so our walk to the Final Four was a lot easier for us, not because we wanted it to, is because the team that we were anticipating on playing wind up losing.
Just the way it unfolded. A short break. Back with more with Phil Sellers and Hollis Copeland, and your phone calls at 1-888-COMCAST as we continue here reflecting back on the Final Four on Comcast Sports Talk. Stay with us. Coming Home is the name of the song, and these guys coming home to talk about the Rutgers glory year, 1975-76 season, when the Scarlet Knights finished 31-2. Phil Sellers, Hollis Copeland, our guest tonight on Comcast Sports Talk. We've got a couple games still to talk about from the run in the NCAA tournament. And Phil, one was against VMI. Now, who was VMI at the time? Nobody really knew, and you had to take them on in Greensboro to go to the Final Four.
They came out of nowhere. A team that we really wasn't anticipating on playing, only because there were teams like Tennessee, DePaul, who they had beat along the way. So we had played against Navy and Army, so we were familiar with cadets. And when we found out that this was a cadet academy, we was like, oh, no way, were we going to let them disrupt what we were, you know, aiming for. And we just had one more game to go before we step into Philly for the Final Four. So VMI was just somebody that we were not going to let get in our way.
Could you start to taste it a little bit, Hollis?
Yeah, you could, but you also had to respect players like Ron Carter,
exactly.
You know, who was a surprise and who no one really counted on doing as well as he did in the NCAA tournament. And he did extremely well. We had the luxury to see him play, and we isolated on that. You know, we tried to keep the ball away from him and try to disrupt their offense as well.
So. All right, let's check in with Jim from Rutherford. You're on Comcast Sports Talk. How you doing, Jim?
I'm doing very well. How are you?
Very good. You got a question?
Yes, I do.
Go right ahead.
Quick question. I am a Rutgers graduate. I played football at Rutgers and graduated in 1972. My high school basketball coach happened to be Dick Vitale, which I believe recruited the majority of the players who were on the team that made it to the Final Four. It came in the middle of the broadcast, and I did not hear anything relative to Mr. Vitale unless it was addressed earlier in the conversation.
No, it wasn't. No. Guys, a little bit about Vitale and his...
I think I can reflect on Dick Vitale. Dick Vitale recruited my senior class, which was myself, Mike Dabney, Jeff Kleinbaum, Mike Paco, Bruce Shear, and a gentleman by the name of Ron Williams.
That was my understanding.
Yes, and I think he did a really tremendous job in bringing that group of guys in. Unfortunately, the following year, the coaching staff had gotten fired. We had anticipated that possibility that Dick Vitale would be offered the head coaching job, which didn't happen.
Yes, that was my understanding also, and I thought that New Jersey, as a graduate of Rutgers University, unfortunately missed a great opportunity in recruiting, or actually they already had him there, but also had a great talent in creating an opportunity. And unfortunately, Rutgers basketball has never gotten back to that point, and hopefully they will. But
Jim, I believe they will. Just reflecting back on Dick Vitale a little bit, I think he scared people a little bit. I mean, if you know anything about Dick Vitale and the way he is, he was talking big time basketball, and the university wasn't ready to make that real big step. They were ready to make a small step, but not the one that Dick Vitale was talking about. So I think in turn, it kind of hurt him a little bit in the sense that it didn't help him get the head coaching job.
But he did get Sellers to Rutgers, and in some of the quotes that I went through, he called Phil a PTP-er, a primetime player, and that quote was well before the time. I'll tell you what, he's done very well in the broadcasting business. You can last a lot longer. It's a lot safer, Hollis. Why deal with the frustrations anyway? Because, you know, you get hired, but eventually you're fired in that game anyway, and he has done extremely well as a broadcaster. But I guess he does have a nice lineage to this, to the Rutgers glory years.
Oh, definitely, definitely. I remember when he recruited and everybody was talking about all the recruits that he had brought in, as well as like Les Kasson, yes, and guys like that, who's, you know, they had great credentials. He always had the gift of gab. You know,
definitely.
Yeah. You know, and that's what you need as far as recruiting. You know, I would have loved to have, you know, played under him during that time. But you're right. He's in a safe position here, and he's made a name for himself in broadcasting.
Well, Hollis Copeland had a heck of a run for the Scarlet Knights of Rutgers. He played four straight years, finished with 1,769 points, 850 career rebounds. He shot 52% from the field. And in that 75-76 season, he averaged almost 13 points per game as a sophomore. He's a 1996 inductee of the Rutgers Hall of Fame. Of course, he played with the Knicks for a couple of seasons, was drafted by the Nuggets in the third round. And Hollis, you look a little slender there, but you've kept your shape over the years. And yes, what about your high-jumping background? Was that really something that helped your grace on the court?
I would say it lent to it, yes. You know, I didn't have the form that I should have had in high-jumping, but, you know, natural ability to jump and run, it definitely helped. You know, being able to jump off of one foot, not having to gather yourself, you know, and being able to take off, it helps tremendously. Players like Michael Jordan, players like that, you know, where they don't have to, you know, gather themselves. Also, playing with players that understood that helped tremendously, because then you can take that quantum leap forward. You know, when they pass you the ball and, you know, they know your abilities and they push your abilities.
Mm-hmm. But an important message for our young viewers, and that is the work ethic. Even though Hollis had all this great talent, he shot only 55% from the foul line as a freshman. And by the time he was a senior, he shot 72%. And Hollis, you can talk all you want about inherent athletic ability. You worked to get to that point.
Oh, yes, and I appreciate your memory bank.
You appreciate the 72 or the 55 figure I brought up?
Both, because, yes, it does. You definitely have to bring your work ethic into play. You know, I always, you know, stayed longer, worked on my shooting. We always used to play on the weekends, and that was a matter of having that camaraderie also. So the work ethic came, and it was there. And each and every year, I wanted to get better and better to help, you know, effectuate our team in a positive manner.
The Rutgers Final Four team are focused tonight on Comcast Sports Talk as we begin to build up to the 1997 Final Four in Indy. Short break, back with Phil Sellers and Hollis Copeland and your phone calls in a moment. Spending the evening talking hoops, Rutgers hoops, with Phil Sellers and Hollis Copeland, and taking your phone calls at 1-888-COMCAST. Before we jump back to the phones, guys, I talked about the UCLA game. You only went up against the likes of Marcus Johnson and Andre McCarter and David Greenwood and Richard Washington. And, Phil, you guys played much better than you had done in the semifinals. You lost 106-92 in a wide-open game. But at least it was the Rutgers team, the offensive team. We got to see a glimpse of
the team
of your,
that people were familiar
yes.
seeing. And, Bruce, it was the biggest team we played against all year. When I saw that lineup step out on the court, I had second thoughts about that game, because of the simple fact that you're talking about some NBA talent out there.
Hollis, you guys took 100 shots in the game. 100 shots. When Villanova won the national championship, they took 10 shots in the second half. This was an up and down, run and gun game. You and Phil both played extremely well. You combined for 41 points and 25 boards, so you had to feel good about the way you guys accounted yourselves that day.
Yeah, at that point, we had monkey off our back. We had lost. We didn't feel good about it, but the pressure was off. And we wanted to show well, you know, play in the consolation game. We knew we were going up against pro talent, so we had a chance to really show ourselves, showcase our talents. And, you know, going up against Marcus Johnson, Richard Washington, Andre McCarter, you know, the scouts were out there, you know, and you wanted to show well. And that's what we tried to do.
I thought Phil did a great job on Marcus Johnson. He only had 30 points and 18 boards. All right, let's go to the phones. Ken from Kearney. How you doing, Ken?
Sure.
Good to have you with us.
Good to be here. This is a great show.
All right, go ahead, Ken. You got the floor. Hello?
Yeah.
Go ahead. You got a question?
Yeah, good. How are you?
All right, let's go to Jameel from Montclair. Hi, Jameel.
How you doing?
Good. How you doing tonight?
Good. My question basically has to do with both Hollis and Phil. First of all, I'd like to know what's going on with Dip Dab, since I'm from his hometown, East Orange.
Well, he called up earlier tonight.
Oh, did he really? I missed it.
We caught up to him. He's also in the financial industry, Phil, right?
He's back here in New Jersey, and it's good to have him back here in New Jersey. And I'm sure he's been up in East Orange, I believe. Of course, East Orange is my hometown now.
Okay.
So, you know, he's been back in the area, and it's good to have him back here on the East Coast. So I'm sure you probably have the opportunity to see him and possibly even run into him.
I'm glad to hear that. Another question I wanted to throw out, Bill, to fill in, Hollis, is to take a look at or to be able to compare when they had the opportunity to go to the NBA versus the athletes going into the NBA today.
Guys, your thoughts, Hollis?
Well, it's a little different, actually, especially when we went to the Final Four, because that's when the NBA, ABA merged. So it was a surplus of ball players during that time. So you had a different perspective. Nobody was going to go hardship, you know, with the surplus of players. Also, I think that a lot of the guys, when we were coming out, you had, three, four rounds.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas now you really have
one round. Makes it to the league nowadays.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly.
You're talking about going away with the second round, just getting rid of it. So, I believe, Phil, that had been in this era, you would have never played your senior year.
Probably not. My senior year, unfortunately, I was drafted third round, and still was able to make the Pistons. I don't think you can do that today.
No. All right, back to the phones at 1-888 Comcast. Robert from Glen Ridge. Robert, how you doing?
How you doing?
Good. Go right ahead, Robert.
Robert, this is Robert. They call me Hook. Phil, I taught Phil and Hollis Copeland how to play basketball.
How you doing, Hook?
How you doing, guy?
All right, buddy.
It's good to hear from you.
Good, guys. I mean, it's good to see you guys, man. Hollis, I haven't seen you, but I have seen Phil, though.
Yeah, I had the opportunity to run into you, and we remember some nice pickup games at Rutgers on the weekends when you used to come down and give us a good challenge.
Oh, yeah. I taught you guys a lot.
Yeah.
You got to remember that. But, you know, I'm coaching here in Highland Park, New Jersey. I'm coaching a girls and a boys team.
Oh, great.
This is our first season, and it was a pretty rough season, but we did okay, though. But, you know, if one of you guys could, I would like for you guys to stop by and talk to my team. I would really appreciate that.
Okay.
Great.
Good, yeah, I would really appreciate it one day you do that. And, you know, Phil, I run into you all the time.
Right. So
I would like to see you sometime too, partner.
No problem, Hook.
Okay?
All right, hopefully you got him hooked.
All right, you take it easy then.
All right, thanks for the call.
Bye-bye.
All right, guys, just a minute left in the show, and this whole week we've been looking back at the Final Four and teams that made it to the Final Four. Hollis, first of all, what did it mean to you from a personal standpoint?
You know, at the time, we were just there having fun. And now, in retrospect, I didn't realize that the guys were that good. You know, when you look back, you reflect back, man, we had a very, very good team. And not only a good team, it was a great bunch of guys. You know, I can really say that each and every member of the team is a dear friend of mine.
Phil, your final memories of the great Rutgers team of 76 that finished 31-2.
Well, you know, Bruce, it was something that I had worked for when I had came in as a freshman. Each year as a freshman, we improved, got better. My junior year was the first time we ever went to the NCAA. So come my final year, my senior year, to actually be in the Final Four was an accomplishment in itself. And to also go undefeated that year was just, you know, really something that as a player you look forward to doing. As a college player, it's something you want to leave back in, you know, in your career, just in case you don't become a professional player. So you can reflect back that you had a great college career.
Well, Indiana was a great team that year and won the national championship, but the Rutgers Scarlet Knights had a memorable great season that they will never forget. Even though they didn't make it to the championship, they went to the Final Four. And Phil Sellers, a pleasure. Hollis Copeland, thanks for joining us. Final words in a moment on Comcast Sports Talk. Stay with us. Don't forget, Monday, 8 p.m., a special time for Comcast Sports Talk. Scott Graham will be the host, and among his guests, Lavelle Sanders of Seton Hall, Jeff Billett of Rutgers, and some other surprise guests. It's a player's look at the Final Four with the championship set to begin that night at 9. So don't forget, Comcast Sports Talk, Monday night at 8 p.m. Thanks to all our guests this week, Mark Plansky and Harold Jensen and Pookie Wigington, and tonight to Phil Sellers and Hollis Copeland as we look back at the Final Four. I'm Bruce Beck. Enjoy the Final Four, and we'll see you next week, everybody.
Sure, there are people with just one side.
Crowd, well done, Sue.
Thank
you didn't say, but you...
Places.
Not before Jerry's here with a preview of sports.
That's right, Kent. The search is over at Rutgers, where they introduced a familiar face today as head coach. The story next.
Thank you so much.
That's right, he's a name that we've been tossing around here for the past few weeks anyway. After nearly a month of searching and interviewing several candidates to fill the basketball coaching vacancy at Rutgers, it turned out to be a very short trip north for Kevin Bannon, who has already made his mark in New Jersey college basketball.
You should have asked me to give you a clue, because as I read the papers this morning, none of you realize what the clue was. This man is from Lawrenceville.
See? 39-year-old Kevin Bannon is not only from Lawrenceville, he's done all of his head coaching in New Jersey, from Division III Trenton State when he was 24, to Ryder, where he spent the last 8 years, taking the Bronx to two NCAA tournament appearances. He calls his new job a dream come true.
As a guy who played high school ball, college ball, Division III coach, Division I assistant, Division I mid-major, and now the Big East, all in the state of New Jersey, you have to know how proud a moment this is for me. I'm very comfortable that we will win more games, and we can do that quickly. I'm even more comfortable. We will do it in a manner that will do nothing but make this university proud. Our players will be in class. Our players will graduate. Get
to know. Clearly, Bannon wasn't the university's first choice to fill the job. In fact, he was the fourth after three others turned down the job. To that, he says,
I mean, I know the question's going to be asked about me not being the first choice and all that kind of stuff, and the way I look at it is the people that I just mentioned and the search committee, you know, dated a few individuals and they married me, and I'm pretty happy about that.
We try to look at this from as many of the analytical points of view as we could, and every time, you know, as they talked to me, because I let the other people that I mentioned talk, Kevin Bannon's name, you know, kept on ringing through my head.
He didn't do too bad in the wallet either. He signed a six-year contract with a base salary of $150,000, but the entire package, including incentives, is worth about $350,000 a year. Elsewhere, it's opening night for the Trenton Thunder as the minor league season.
Basketball coach. He made light of the fact that he wasn't quite their first choice.
I mean, I know the question's going to be asked about me not being the first choice and all that kind of stuff. And the way I look at it is the people that I just mentioned and the search committee, you know, dated a few individuals and they married me, and I'm pretty happy about that.
And he said it was really the highlight of his life, so congratulations to him.
Absolutely.
Best sports.
Thanks,
Len. Thank
well, don't have...
You know, dated a few individuals and they married me.
Well, prior to Bannon's arrival at Ryder, Ryder had just two winning seasons in 13 years, but he produced five winning seasons in 8 years and went to the tournament twice. Prior to Ryder, he coached at Trenton State. His overall record at the Division III school was 145-48. So Bannon's gone from D3 to the Big East without moving beyond a 25-mile radius. He's efficient, too. Well, on the heels of winning the regular season,
embarrassed by having four other guys turn it down before this native son got his big break.
Okay. Well, I don't know where anybody's been able to make three coaching jumps within a 25-mile radius. It's, somebody's looking after me. I feel very blessed, and I'm just so excited about this opportunity. Being from New Jersey my whole career and my whole life, for that matter, and to coach the state university that has so much, you know, potential. This is the challenge I've always wanted, and there's no other way to say it.